wonderful to hear that. So let me just back up a little bit and explain how I got on this journey of the mind. Obviously, I had another career. So what made me so interested in this was, I'll just back it up a little bit. About 6 years ago, I was outed by Comic Relief. I never told anybody I had a mental illness. I kept that very stum. But then they outed me because they said, could they use my photo for their campaign for mental illness? I said, sure. And I thought it was going to be a little postage-sized stamp thing. But instead, it was this gigantic poster they put up of me in the tube station that said, this woman has mental illness. Please help her. I was mortified. I couldn't believe that. And I looked like a Lithuanian peasant. It was like sick. And then I saw them all over London, grotesque. So I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to write a show and make that look like it's my publicity post. So I was now forced to write a show about mental illness. And I toured mental institutions for 2 years. And they loved it, I think. They weren't always facing me, but I think that they liked it. And if you can make a schizophrenic laugh, you're halfway to Broadway. And the bipolars used to say, I laughed, I cried. And then I had a big fan base from the psychopaths. They still love me. I still get letters saying, I'm going to kill you, but it's a fan base. It's a fan base. So, I mean, what was so fantastic was that I found my people. I found them. I had been searching, but there they were, and they had the same kind of look that I have in my eyes. And it was such a relief because none of these people, when you said, how are you, said fine. And we could talk about our symptoms and drugs for hours and hours, whereas on the outside, you always bore people senseless. And they were like, they understood, and this is why I became a mental illness, mental health campaigner, is that they understood that depression has nothing to do with being sad. It's an unfortunate word, but it has nothing that the public should really understand. It's not because you had a bad hair day, or even that your husband left town. This is where there's no sensation at all. It's a brain disease, and it feels like people say, are you creative when you're in this state? Read my lips. It feels like somebody made a slot up here and then dumped cement through your whole body. So you're gone. You're in a coma. You're gone. And even to lift your hand is as difficult as running the triathlon. So nothing is working. So that was, I thought, an important thing to mention. But then it turned out, you know, and I toured this all over the world, finally, outside with normal people, whatever that is. But it wasn't just the 1 in 4 who have a mental problem. I realized it was 4 in 4. Because halfway through the show, we always had a conversation, even in the mental institutions. And the people who were normal asked the same questions as the other people. So I thought, oh, this is interesting. And I realized, you know, that we're all bombarded by bad news. We all have those critical voices. I've never met anybody in all the tours that has a voice that says, I'm doing a wonderful job, and may I say how attractive you are today? Nobody has that. Nobody. I mean, we're all screwed, basically, because we're bombarded, all of us, day and night by bad news, you know, and our poor little brain can't tell if there's danger right behind us or it's halfway across the world. You know, why should I be bothered? Why should I be affected if there's a 3.6 earthquake in Dong Dong Dong? Why do I have to know that? Or there's a shark attack in Malawi? Or there's a flood in brain dead Nebraska? Do I have to know that? And what can I do about it? Get a hand pump and a bucket? What can I do? I mean, as human beings, we were only supposed to know what our neighbors were doing. That was our state, right? If the woman next door was having sex next door to her, I should know this. But 4 doors down, I don't care. Do you understand? So we're in constant terror. Constant terror. I mean, and also that digital Viagra is driving us. You know, it keeps us moving forward. We used to think if we had technology, we'd have spare time. Now we wouldn't know spare if it came up and hit us on the head. It's like saying, let's get some spare oxygen. Nothing. So we're all in this situation together, but I was really interested as to why the critical voices. I mean, that was to me fascinating. And I thought, well, I'm going to go to school and learn how the brain works, okay? And then I'll feel, you know, that I understand. I'm on top of the situation. It was an extreme move. So I crashed UCL on a neuroscience course with all these 21-year-olds. And I told them I had that disease that made me look like I was really old. So I'd fit in. And then much later, they found out I really was old. But it didn't matter because I was the one with the car. So they graduated. I didn't graduate. Obviously, I crashed the course. So really what I don't understand is why none of us, why isn't it the headlines in the newspaper of really what's going on in our heads? It's 2013. We should have a roadmap. You know, everybody used to ask, who am I? What's my meaning? Just look in your brain. It's extraordinary. There are no voices. I mean, and if the voice, it's a teeny little grain of sand compared to the ocean liner the size of Mars, which is what's driving you up here. I mean, there's 100 billion neurons. It's like 100 billion Las Vegases sending lights, electricity to different parts of your brain, telling you, oh, I feel pain because of this. It goes to your memory. I'm in love because you remind me of Kurt Russell. You know, it's got pictures. It's got memories. This is who you are. And then you make certain habits just because you want to adapt. So every time I get in a frightening situation, I always smile and get really aggressive. That's me. And that's a certain pathway. All these neurons harden up. And that's a habit that I've created. And other people get scared and they hunker like little animals. Okay, that's another habit. And all these ways of adapting that we get used to becomes our personality. And all the other neurons atrophy. So we get locked into this mode of behavior. Now see, everything was okay hundreds of thousands of years ago. We were really well adapted. Okay, we didn't quite be, we weren't able to use our thumbs. And we had a lot of body hair. But emotionally, we were right there. You know, nobody had OCD. There was no anorexia. Nobody bringing up their lunch. Everything was fine. Okay, and then when we'd feel a predator, right, we'd do, which was something that was perfect for our bodies. We'd fill up with cortisol and adrenaline. You know, these are to get the hard, fast hits where you turn in from a nice guy into a killer. And then we'd take on the situation. We'd take it on. We'd either be killed or we'd kill, or we'd be lunch or we'd have lunch. And if we survived, all the cortisol and adrenaline would come back down, and we'd go back to being calm and serene. We'd go back to grazing or whatever it is we did. So the problem is these days, in this culture, the cortisol and adrenaline, everything is a threat. Everything is scary to us. Now, we didn't know, the brain didn't know this culture was coming. And everything fuels it. Again, the brain doesn't know if it's back there. Or, oh, the newspapers are helpful because you open it up, everybody's been murdered. Every single person's dead. And so, I don't know if we're addicted to this stuff, but we don't shut it down. And now what's even worse is that we don't just feel physical threat, that there's really a bear behind us, which I doubt, but we feel social fear. So if somebody doesn't accept you on Facebook, in your brain, it registers in the same area as if you were shot in the foot. It doesn't know. So the cortisol and the thing, you know, it just keeps going. And so we want to be the best. You know, that's where actually the voices kick in. You know, it says you're not good enough. You don't want to fail. God help it. It's doing the best it can. It's trying to save us. And by the way, nobody has a voice, as I said before. And if you did have a voice that said, oh, what a beautiful morning, that's not good for survival. You'd be hit by the next truck. So we all have a proclivity to those negative voices. But they're coming so fast because the fear is coming so fast. And so we live in this state of, oh my God, I didn't get an email. Oh my God, I can't twerk as well as Miley Cyrus. Everything is driving us nuts. I can, but most people can't. Which I will do for you later. But there is good news. There is a light at the end of the tunnel. And again, I don't get why this isn't written everywhere. There's this thing now, science knows there's neuroplasticity, which means you can change the way you are. And by the way, all the way until you die. The neurons, if you keep curious and you keep changing patterns, you break out of those habits. Boy, does this keep alive, you know, but with old people, they get stuck. Every day at 4, they sit. Then they watch TV. We should kick them in the ass and say, come on, learn tango, learn Chinese, jump, parachute jump. You're old, what's the difference if you die? We should know this, you know. So knowing that that the neurons can change just by the way you think, just by the way you experience things, and just by feelings, all those wires keep changing. But we're stuck in our pattern. And by the way, I know everybody's going to say, well, don't genes have to do with it? But now they know that the way you think and the way you behave affects the genes and changes the genes. But again, where's this information? You know, so knowing that, I thought, how do you regulate that stuff? I mean, I'm addicted to adrenaline. You know, everybody has their kind of, we're chemicals. That's it, babe. That's all you are, is a walking cocktail. Really. And everybody has their thing. Like, I'm addicted to adrenaline. I wait for the taxi to come, and then I pack for the airport. Because I love that buzz. You know, I get in the car when it's, you know, I got to get to the appointment, and it was 10 days ago. So I'm beeping, and I'm saying, fuck you, out the window. And I was just going to get my nails painted blue. I've killed people. But I get that rush, you know, that's my addiction. Other people have really healthy drugs, like they have oxytocin. You know, that's their main motif. And those people are really lovely and mumsy and milky. And they're the type of people that go, no, it's okay, you get in front of me. I have very little of this drug. Some people have that serotonin, you know, which even if there's a Holocaust, they're feeling good. I have to buy that stuff over the counter. But the real killer is dopamine. That's what really drives us. That's the busyness one. We can't stop. So I thought, okay, how do I pull the reins? You know, nobody gives you this information. If there's a way of, you know, with this neuroplasticity, there must be some way of changing the way I think and changing the way I feel to make sure that I'm, you know, I'm more balanced, that I don't get whooshed, which used to happen with the depression, hit with that tsunami of cortisol. And it just, you know, takes me down a river and drowns me. So I thought, there must be some way I can get this down. So I did research. I was quite curious. And, you know, I didn't want to do a weekend course on how to hug your inner elf. I turned that one down. So I researched brain science. You know, I went to the mothership. And it turns out that mindfulness, which I never would have done in a million years, because I keep thinking, oh, that's some guy with a bindi on his head, worshiping an elephant with 2,000 arms. So I thought, oh, no, and I'm not going to tell anybody I'm doing this. But it turns out that has the best results, not just for preventing depression, but for OCD, people who are burned out, for stress, for just feeling better, for really it covers the whole spectrum. And there's research to show that the cortisol does come down. So I said, well, who's the founder of this? So because I have that adrenaline, I hunted down the founder of mindfulness. See, adrenaline's good sometimes, but if you keep it on too long, it will burn you out. So it's got a good, bad effect. I hunted him down. I went to Oxford, and there was Mark Williams, and I said, well, will you teach me this? And he said, okay. And he gave me the 8-week course for free. I'm Jewish, can you imagine how happy I was? For free. So I thought, oh, this is great. Anyway, I was interested, but I need to know what happens in the brain that makes this thing work, because I'm obsessed with, you know, the reality of everything. So he said, well, unfortunately, you'll have to get into Oxford if you want to learn that, and he kind of laughed. But again, because of the adrenaline and the dopamine, I have the drive of a Rottweiler. But this is why sometimes I slam in a wall, because we can't shut it down. So I got all my good report cards, which was 2, and and then my SAT scores, you know what that was? I really tip X those out, because I had the intelligence of a houseplant. So I just got rid of that. But then I give really good interview. Yeah, I know how to. I've learned over the years how to bullshit when you don't know what you're talking about. No, so anyway, it was a he called me. He couldn't believe it that I got in there. And there were 16 other students, you know, who were geneticists or, you know, grown-ups. And they looked at me like there had been some hideous mistake. So, you know, I said, screw them, I got in. And the greatest thing, you wear that square thing on your head and you dress like a bat. And the guy who runs it is like Dumbledore. It's the happiest day of my life. My parents wouldn't just turn over in their grave. They would just, their heads would fall off. So not only do you see what happens in the brain scanner, but you do learn mindfulness. They kind of make you walk the talk, which was so hard. So basically, I'll just make it real simple, though it isn't. Basically, how to deal with those thoughts, and it seems counterintuitive. Rather than run away and jog in the morning or whatever we do to avoid what's going on, which eventually will bite you in the ass, you learn to just sit down and notice your thinking. You just notice it. And if you actually have the nerve to face the garbage that's going on, and again, it's like mine right now is everybody hates me, nobody's listening, I'm a fraud. That's my theme song. I don't know what yours is. But, you know, that's going by. There is a part of the brain where you can sit back and watch that, like it's on a TV. But, of course, then you get caught up in it and there's, you know, there's more of a story. But you start to notice there's different qualities of your thinking. One is really good because we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for that. There's a part of our brain that makes us problem solve, analyze, create. You know, it's the greatest thing on earth. But here's a glitch. This is a flaw in the machine. Sometimes when we're emotionally trying to figure something out, like why your boyfriend left you, or why you can't, you know, why you feel like a failure, that's rumination. There will never be an answer. You'll be up all night trying to figure out why you can't be Miley Cyrus. Up all night, you'll never come to a conclusion. It's this disease called rumination. And this is what drives you to burnout, and for the extreme cases, to mental illness. It's that chewing away, because that cortisol really does its damage. So when you notice that you're thinking like that, okay, you don't punish yourself. That's just where you are. So you learn to sit really still and notice those thoughts. Now, in order to not get caught up in that thought stream, to get caught up in that argument that you're doing, you gotta have an anchor. Because otherwise, that brain's had you captive for 20 or 30 or 40 years. It ain't giving up easily. So now what you have to do is find an anchor. Now, I know this sounds easy, but if you send your attention to one of your senses, you know, touch, sight, sound, taste, well, you know what they are. This isn't fluffy stuff. This is actual, you know, when you send your attention inside your body, there's another part of the brain called the insula that becomes active. The reason we're always stressed and we're out of our minds with anxiety is because that alarm bell called the amygdala's up. That's what makes us such a wreck. That's what drives us, you know, always thinking there's bad news and turns on the cortisol. When you activate the insula and you send your attention, let's say, to hearing, here's the thing. You're tricking your brain because you can't be anxious and experience a sensation at the same time. It's like a car, you can't put it in two gears. Okay, that sounds easy, but I'll give you a little bite size, it works. You can't be thinking future, past, and listening or feeling a sensation because it brings you into the present. Because I'm not listening yesterday. You can't be in those two modes. So just as an experience, let's just listen for 10 seconds. And just notice what's going on. Now, your brain will want you back, but just keep taking it back to the listening. Okay. You'll notice that, and this is happening to everybody, you're not alone. Your mind wants you back, and it wants to pass judgment, or it says, I hate you so much for doing this. or it wants to have lunch. This is what minds do. We are dragged, like we are dragged like there's a piece of meat in front of us. But it's our chemicals. We are in a high state of alarm. That's the way it is. But when you sit and bring it into your body, actually you start to notice those thoughts aren't solid, that they come and go, and some are harsh and some are light. But it's not solid. I mean, when I'm feeling horror or whatever and I focus on that, I realize the rest of my body isn't in that state. I'm not depressed, my arm isn't. So you focus in or you focus on the thoughts and they disperse. Does that make sense to you? The really important thing though is when you notice, you don't give yourself a hard time about it, because that sort of screws us up even more, like we're stressed and then we get really stressed about being stressed. Like I'm stressed, but now I'm going, you're an idiot for feeling stressed. Or I'm anxious and then I think, come on, pull out of it, pull out of it. So we get a double arrow. You know, you get the first thing, right? That it just exists, watch it. But then we send it another arrow and the adrenaline and the whole thing, it exasperates it. I mean, somebody said pain is pain, but suffering is optional. So you just learn to pay attention to what is. I mean, what mindfulness really is learning, this sounds so easy, to pay attention to what's right there. Because you might say, I'm paying attention to me, or you might say it, but actually, you're tweeting, you know, and you're thinking about Bulgaria. And you're thinking, but we don't know how to focus. And what this mindfulness does, by this constant noticing what's going on in the mind, just notice, and bringing it back to something in the body, or your bottom of your feet, or you're stroking a cat, you're inside your body, it's interception. It's like doing a sit-up. So you notice where your mind goes, and you bring it back. You notice where it goes, you bring it back. This is how you get to know yourself, or know your themes, but without giving yourself a hard time, you bring it back. This is what therapists really do. They listen to your shit, but they charge you a lot of money for it. But they stay compassionate, you know, and they stay accepting. And so it's almost like it's okay to hear those thoughts. So with mindfulness, you're sort of listening. You're listening just like a shrink does, but you're kind of forgiving yourself for it. And it's that compassion that helps you then be compassionate to the next person, because you know that crap's going on in their head. And when that red mist starts to come down, which is what mindfulness does, it will calm that thing down. It's like, I always think, sitting at the bottom of an ocean, and there's turbulence up there, there's crap going on, but I'm just at the bottom. So when I listen to you, or I have to work with you, I have the space to be able to feel what you feel. Otherwise, we're just all in our own worlds, and we're talking at each other. And we blame it on the world. You know, we blame it on the Muslims or the ice melting or who's prime minister. I always think, well, how'd he get in there? He didn't drop from heaven. There's always something niggling us, but the war is in our brains. There's always that conflict. We're arguing with ourselves, and until we learn to resolve that screaming in there, there will always be war. So that's my speech on world peace. That's enough now. So it starts with you. It's regulating my brain, which will have a ripple effect on yours and communities and the world, because we work like neural Wi-Fi. We infect each other. If you think we don't, go to a movie and watch how everybody screams at the same time or laughs at the same time. We're completely connected. And if I change my little self, then I'm able to hit it onto you. You spread your positivity and you spread your negativity. So all I can think of, listen, I'm not an evangelist. It doesn't have to be mindfulness, but it has to be something that brings you in under the words, under the attack. So it could be Tai Chi, you know, when you go into your body, because then the adrenaline comes down. It could be, what is it, that Kai Kuang? Kong Kwai? Kong Kong? That other one. It could be any martial art. It could be yoga. As long as you're in your body, and here's my problem, usually it's just some babe standing there to show me that she can kiss her behind from both directions. So it's all about forgiving. It's all about compassion to yourself. I hate using these words, but it all comes down to that. So the other bonus you get with this is you start to, this is, sounds like it's sort of fluffy. But what this also does, it gives you a chance to come into the present, which is a land we don't visit very much. I mean, not a, you'll have it by accident. You know, you'll be on a trip and go, oh my God, I just noticed that. Or you'll have it for a second, but we have no means, you know, no, we haven't got the mechanism to pull the brakes and just be right here. So a bonus of mindfulness is that you can either use that brain to go get, because we need, but once you know you've gone over your tipping point, you can pull the brakes, just go into your body, and then you're there. It makes you able to be more aggressive because you've gone on the back leg, and now you've got more fuel, because you can't, you know, it just exasperates, and then you can't think clearly. In stress, the first thing to go is memory. That's why kids should really learn when they're working on their tests, they're going to just screw up. The, you know, the anxiety makes the neurons in the hippocampus die, that, and this is where memory is. So basically, you know, I wish I knew it when I was younger, because I used to be with my kids, one of my kids is here, and they'd be telling me about, you know, their dead hamster, and I should help them with the funeral arrangements. I know they were doing that, but I can't remember because I was on two telephones at the same time. They thought these things were growing out of my ears. And there was always that next email. I can't even remember who I was emailing, so I missed it. I missed the whole thing. And now, just this habit of learning to throw focus, is it's agonizing, but you realize I'm doing emails to people I don't even know. I'm tweeting, who the fuck are these people? Why am I doing this? Instead of whipping the, you know, yourself to death, you put down the telephone, you put down the computer, and intentionally you throw that focus. And you've learned to do that by working that insula. You're there, you're looking, your feet are on the ground. So I hope in the next millennium or whatever's coming that we learn to be, well, that it isn't survival of the fittest, it becomes survival of the wisest. So thank you very much.